So what's interesting is that when we work with data in the real world, it doesn't come to us as nicely formatted feature vectors. Instead, it comes to us as database records or protocol buffers or whatever else. We need to take that data from those heterogeneous data sources and create feature vectors from it. Now, the process of extracting features from raw data is called feature engineering, and it's what real-life machine learning people spend, I don't know, something like 75% of their time doing. The features are the thing. So let's take a look at how this might happen. If we have a record that is naturally represented as a real value, like number of rooms in a house, we can just copy that over into a feature vector. And that's very natural. But what if we get a string like Main Street? What do we do then? If we see a string value, we can often translate that into a feature vector by using a one-hot encoding. Now, the one-hot encoding has a unique coefficient for each possible string we might see. So, for example, if we have a one-hot encoding for street names, we'll have a unique coefficient for each possible street. And then when we see this street we have, say Main Street, we'll put a 1 in the coefficient for Main Street and a 0 everywhere else. Don't worry, we can represent that compactly. And we'll use that as our feature vector for representing strings. One-hot encodings are extremely handy for this sort of sparse categorical data. Now, what makes a feature a good feature? Well, the first thing is that a feature should occur with a non-zero value at least a handful of times or more in our data set. If a feature occurs with a non-zero value only extremely rarely, or maybe only once, it's probably not a great feature to use and should maybe be filtered out in a pre-processing step. Our features should have a clear and obvious meaning. This allows us to do good sanity checking and debugging to make sure that our features are being processed properly. For example, it's much easier to have a house age in units of years than a house age in seconds since Unix epoch. Much easier to debug and reason about. So features shouldn't take on magic values. So for example, it would be a bad idea if we had a feature whose job it was to tell us how many days a house had been on the market for us to use a special value of -1 to show that that house had never been on the market. Instead, a better idea would be to have an indicator feature that would take on a Boolean value showing whether our days on the market feature was defined or not. So we could have a Boolean, true, false, 1, 0, to show is that other feature defined. And this allows the original feature, days on the market, to maintain its natural units of 0 through n. The third thing is that our feature values shouldn't change over time. This goes back to the idea of stationarity in our data. Now, why might a feature value change over time? Well, maybe our features come to us from some upstream model that might change. We'd like to be able to version that and have, you know, a very specific sense, or to be able to get values out of that model that are really do have well-defined constant semantics. Last thing is that a feature should not have crazy outlier values. So for example, in our California housing data, if we create a synthetic feature, like rooms per person, where we take the total rooms and divide it by the total population, we get some reasonable values of between 0 and 3 or 4 rooms per person for most city blocks. But on some city blocks, we've got values as high as 50, which is insane. I mean, where are these people living? Like hotel blocks? So a thing we can do there is maybe cap or transform our features so that we get rid of those crazy outlier values. One other trick to think about is the binning trick. So if we think about, say, the effect of latitude on housing prices in California, there is no sort of linear relationship from north to south that maps directly to housing prices. But within any particular latitude, there often is a pretty strong correlation. And so what we can do is we can take that north to south latitude and bucket it up into a bunch of little bins. These each become Boolean features. We can use a one-hot encoding here. And essentially what we get is a 1. Now, if you are in the particular bin that maps to, say, San Diego, or a 1 if you're in the particular bin that maps to the South Bay Area, and a 0 everywhere else. This allows our model, you know, a cheap way to map some of those non-linearities into our model without doing any special tricks. So let's think about some good habits here. It's incredibly important to know your data. It's not really a good practice to just sort of treat machine learning as a black box, throw it at data without inspecting the data and hope you get good results, because there will be quirks in your data. So things you can do. You can visualize your data using histograms or scatter plots, various rank metrics. You can do various data debugging that ends up consuming a lot of time for model development, looking for duplicate values, missing values, anything that looks like an outlier, anything that looks like a dashboard that you can interact with your data can be incredibly helpful. And finally, we want to monitor our data over time. Just because our data sources were good yesterday does not mean they're going to be good tomorrow. And so anything we can do to add monitoring to the stability of our features over time will increase the robustness of our systems.